against a very formidable opponent. But you're better than your opponent. So be tall, beautiful, have your hair all over your head. Anything you want, take your, be proud of who you are. And go for it. Because they're going to diss you anyway. You're going to get punished for being tall, beautiful, and proud. Or tall, intelligent, and articulate. Any number of things that can be used against you. So to be the best you can be, that's the key, always. The best you can be. And if you're smart, if you're not acting white, they don't own smartness. And when people say they do, that's self-hatred, okay? Please, what kind of craziness is that? You can code switch, you can be trilingual, you can speak. I speak Black Southern, White Southern, Canadian, whatever I'm required to do, and standard English, okay? So we need to be fluently multilingual, and that's a skill. And I pride myself in being smart. I always have. And I also, my mama was a English crazy. So we had to speak correctly. But we tried not to do it outside the home because you get ridiculed sometimes. Like, you try to talk so proper, you think you're so cute. You don't have to listen to that. Of course you think you're cute. And of course you try to talk so proper because the colonial language of this country is English. So learn it. And learn as many other languages as you can, in addition. Learn another colonial language, okay? Just become the best. So I've been with a lot of Black student groups, and y'all make me mad, and I deal with it and come back and check you when you say something that I don't agree with. I've gone to colleges where I was invited by the Black Student Union and nobody came except for the chicken that was served before the event, and then they all went home. So I can be caustic, and that made me mad, okay? I'm in a sorority, I'm a defunct sorority member. My sorority sisters will come to the beginning of my event, give me a gift, and then leave. So don't play. I don't play. That makes me mad. That upsets me. They need to be there. I have things to say that are important. I have, because I'm a wise old woman. So, okay, I'm shutting. You want to ask questions? Yes.
Well, I'm a senior now, so I'm basically leaving, but do you have any advice for anybody who is, like, freshman and sophomore who go to a predominantly white school?
Well, how about you tell me what it's like?
Share.
It was a hard transition because I came from like a school where there were basically no white people, and then like coming to SI where I can see I'm a minority now. Like I realize my Blackness. It was hard, especially with like everybody around us is like, I mean, everybody at our age is ignorant, you know, of like world issues and stuff like that, and they're just saying whatever comes to mind, and it was like, I was really uncomfortable. So how do I deal with that uncomfortableness?
Okay, so hashtag profound intentional ignorance, okay? You have to put that out. That's my phrase, because I think it describes the nation. We are profoundly intentionally ignorant, okay? Never before has there been so much access to information, and yet we stay and actually pride ourselves in being profoundly ignorant. So I think you say that in your head and say, they're just profoundly intentionally ignorant, and I can't be compromised by it. because you live in this country. It is a very sick country. And you can't take on that illness because then you won't get where you need to be. So the struggle, it continues to be. I don't think you can call people on all their stupidity. But you can ask an institution. Okay, I've seen some of the slogans around here. You can ask the school to live up to its slogans and tell them how they're not. Because that's the cool thing about when they write it down, you can challenge people on it, right? So keep that in mind. If it's written there and you don't see it, you need to tell somebody you don't see it. Don't go alone, go with a delegation, 3 or 4, and say, you're not living up to this because of the following reason. The first principle of nonviolence is, nonviolence is a way of life for courageous people. So first you have to be courageous. But on the opposite side of action, nonviolent action, the first is to get educated about your issue. You can't go half knowing something and challenging somebody. You gotta know what your issue is, know what they're saying, know what you want, because it's not easy. You have to work. So it's not an instant thing, so you get together and say, the following things are posted, but you're not upholding it. And here is why, because in this instance, this is what's happening to me. So you don't have to take it. This is the 2018. This is the best time to do all kinds of things. Your Parkland kids, Little Rock 9, gave you the example. Stop being so docile and letting things happen without doing something about it. It was 60 years ago, but if you see my photos, I was smoking. Okay, so I'm kidding. So we don't let anything, we don't let things stop us. That's the key, I think. If I were to say, what is a Little Rock 9 lesson? Is we don't let crazy people, crazy institutions, crazy government, crazy schools, crazy presidents, crazy governors stop us, okay? You got that, you got that. You got that more than we did. You have access to information. You can instantly communicate with each other. The world is watching, and we don't look so good, folks. We look like we're just pretty boring and not so willing to step out and fight for what we need, what is right for humanity, what is right for kids. The world's watching. And that's a good thing. Because they're watching you, but they're also watching them and they're saying, they are nuts. That's the general outside the U.S. attitude. God, they're crazy. Except for the kids. So you have an opportunity, you have role models. Don't take it anymore, okay? And sometimes it's about blackness, but sometimes it's about humanity, and it's about all of us. But we've got to do more of that coalition. I don't want to be. Little Rock is not a black history story. It is a United States history story. So when we sort of take some part of history and we say, that's ours. Well, no. It's the story of our nation. And we need to use that story to challenge. Hey, this is who we are. If you put it in black history, nobody sees it but you. But when you talk about it as a historical event in this country, you say, this is who we are. Are we still those people? Or have we changed? So I urge you to demand that your school have Eyes on the Prize documentary series. Do they have it? Have you seen it?
We're watching it now.
Somebody made you do it. No, I'm just kidding. So yeah, so this is information for everybody, right? There are maybe 300 books about Milwaukee. It is one of the most studied American historical events because it was about the Constitution, the federal court, the Supreme Court, the 14th Amendment, state versus federal conflict, constitutional conflict, just huge mob violence, all kinds of stuff. So everybody has written about it. And it's well worth looking at it. So,
I know folks, more and less folks who need to go to class right now. You're excused if you want to go. I'll write you a note. A couple of you guys are going to be late. I understand. Folks just want to stay. I'm not sure if we want to take her to lunch now. We'll give her a couple more minutes, and then we'll break this party within the next five or so.
You ready to get done?
Yeah. I mean, unless you have a burning question.
Before you leave, I got to show you. Yeah, this is amazing. Okay.
Well, here it is. Can I get a photo with our BSU members?
Sure. If they